And the time is 7 p.m. If you would please stand for the prayer and pledge. And join with me in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you so much for this day and everything you've given us. Thank you for allowing us to live in such a wonderful city where we can not only love each other and care for each other, but come together as a community and do great things. Please be with us tonight as we make decisions that will affect the city. And may we be mindful of the decisions that we make and the effects that they have. Please be with those that are sick and hurting. We lift them up to you, Lord. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Yeah.
Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Okay, second item, approval of the agenda.
Move to approve.
Second.
Got a first and second. Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Motion carries. Third item, citizens' comments.
Mayor, the sign-up sheet is gone. If it was there, somebody took it. So if they signed up, they need to tell you.
Did anybody want to speak tonight? Okay. Well, we'll take that as a no comments tonight. Fourth item is awards and recognition. Nothing tonight. Fifth item, public announcements. I know there's a community play going on this weekend. I think you can find the details. I think it's Thursday, Friday, and maybe Sunday. Friday, Saturday, Sunday. Yes, so you can get the details. Exciting. I think there's a middle school play. Is that correct? Is that this weekend?
High school.
Okay. Well, we got lots of theater, so if you're into the arts, check it out and get the times, and I'm sure they would appreciate any support. You could give them anything else from the commissioners you can think of in the community that's going on. Okay. I think Keith will probably tell us about Earth Day, so I'll let him. I'm not going to steal his thunder. Item six would be staff comments, and looks like nothing from Ms. Johnson. Mr. Daugherty's out. Mr. Hall, did you have something?
No, ma'am.
Okay. And then Mr. Paisley.
Yeah, we're just announcing save the date type thing for Earth Day, April 22nd. There's going to be a lot going on in the park. Friends of the Nature Park have a lot of activities going on, as well as park staff. And once we get a little bit closer, we'll announce a little bit more detail to it. But you could go to, I believe our website has that information, or even the Friends would have that.
Okay, great. And Keith, when's the camp sign-ups going to start?
It's been going on for a while. I believe they got almost two full camps so far.
Oh, wow.
So it's going well.
Okay, great. Okay, approval of the consent agenda.
Motion to approve.
Second.
We have a first and second. Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
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 Opposed? Motion carries. Old business? There is none, so we'll move on to new business. 10A, discuss and take action on ordinance number 2017-04.
An ordinance to change the zoning of certain property in the city of Fairview, Tennessee, located off Old Nashville Road, owned by Jennifer Rose Buford, Rita Olivia Kidder, and James Ricky Jones, as shown on Williamson County Tax Map 42, Parcel 74, Map 42, Parcel 79, and Map 22, Parcel 167, from RS40 to RS15, RPUD.
Okay.
Move to approve.
We got a first. Second. I second it. Discussion.
What exactly entails in the rezoning?
Are you the part of the land owner or?
No, I live across the street.
Oh, okay. Mr. Hall, can you come up and, you know, give a little information?
They're asking for the attorney to draw up the papers to go forward with the rezoning request.
No, this is first read, Mr. Hall.
This is the first reading, then. Then the second reading will have the rezoning as well as the public hearing first. At the public hearing, you can come and speak, whether you're for or against. And if you come up to speak, as many as the neighbors that want to can come and speak at that time. There's no limit or time limit on how long you speak.
Because this happened so quickly, if I didn't live across the street, I wouldn't have seen the sign.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. We'll get an opportunity for a public hearing. Yes, go
Mayor,
ahead.
Just to make sure I understand the question, I think your question is, what does this mean? How does that, how, mm-hmm. what is
What's
taking place across the street? If we can kind of get into some detail about that now, or if you would like to stay until after the meeting for a few minutes, we can kind of walk you through and let you see what that is.
Okay.
And kind of get you some information to be educated on it when you come at the next, if that's okay with,
yeah, that's
with
fine.
Mayor and Commission.
Mayor, well, let me ask this. I mean,
okay.
And it would be so beneficial if, for us and for people in the audience,
mm-hmm.
if we had some sort of definition of what the difference is that we're changing from and to.
Mm-hmm.
So, and I think that's what she's asking. So we're changing from our RS-40, which means?
1 unit per acre.
Yep.
And we're changing to a RS-15 RPUD?
That's right.
Which is?
Which means it's a base density, and I don't know the calculation, I don't have it in front of me, but it's 2.
It's effectively an average.
2.2 units per acre.
And does that include the land we have to set aside for the, I mean, but these have sewer taps. These are actually on sewer taps and not the.
That's right.
Go ahead.
I believe the way this was explained at the Planning Commission is that Water Authority of Dixon has said, we'll give you 20. And then once you use all those, they'll release another 20. So these are going to be sewer taps, I believe, on this project. when we're talking about the density switching to 2.2, right now it's one house per acre. You can do 2.2, so you can, in essence, fit more in that area, because you have some open space requirements, some green space, and it helps you kind of, in theory, make up for some of those things.
So it's 39 acres? Is that the?
That's
13 acres.
39 lots.
Okay. So 39 lots on 13 acres.
Commissioner Lucas, go ahead.
And so that I'm clear, the what's on the table tonight, if we vote yes, then after this we have the public hearing to hear if citizens want to comment. Correct? Just so I'm clear on that.
Yes, that's correct.
You're required by law to have a public hearing before the second reading.
Ms. Johnson, you had something to add?
Is anyone here tonight representing this property?
Mm-mm.
That's what I was going to ask.
No,
and I don't believe if they're here, we can't go forward on this and have to defer it to the
that's
next
correct.
Meeting.
But let's clarify before we move forward with this. When we pass, we rezone a PUD, we're rezoning it as it's presented, because going back to Cumberland, that's how you explained
the,
it.
The PUD plan becomes the zoning, and you can't change the PUD unless you come back to the board to change the PUD.
Right.
So once you pass that, the PUD plan becomes the zoning if it's R-15, and if they want to change anything on the plan, let's say, for example, it didn't go and they want to change it back to something else, you can cancel the PUD, you can revise the PUD, you can go to something else, but it has to come back just like a zoning. But the only time that you don't have to have someone here is if it's simply by ordinance, you've got to have somebody here representing the development, unless, like the next one on there, is for the purpose of preparing the instruments. That actually doesn't affect the building owner in any way, so they don't have to be here for that through the board to authorize, because it's just a concurrence of the board. They're not actually approving that. They're just saying, okay, go ahead and do the documents.
Okay, well, we won't be able to vote on this item, but any other discussions while we're on the topic? So we'll put it on the next.
They'll also need to defer the next one, because that's a resolution for the public hearing.
Yeah. Okay, so did I get a motion to defer?
Motion to defer.
Okay.
Second.
Got a second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Motion carries. Get a motion for, well, go ahead and read the caption. Do we need to?
On B?
On B. Read the caption.
Discuss and or take action on resolution 03-17, a resolution to set a public hearing for the purpose of obtaining public comment on changing the zoning and establishing PUD status of certain property in the city of Fairview, Tennessee, located off Old Nashville Road, owned by Jennifer Rose Buford, Rita Olivia Kidder, and James Ricky Jones, as shown on Williamson County Tax Map 42, Parcel 74, Map 42, Parcel 79, and Map 22, Parcel 167, from RS-40 to RS-15 PUD.
Move to defer.
Second.
Okay, got a first and second to defer. Any more discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Motion carries. Item C, discuss and take action on recommendations from the Planning Commission for rezoning requests for Lot 2 of Donald H. Tidwell subdivision from RM-12 to R-20, Map 23, Parcel 44.01, 4.74 acres, owner Donald M. and Rosemary Cunningham, Revocable Trust.
Move to approve.
That's just for preparing the instruments.
Yeah.
Second.
Got a first and second. Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Motion passes. Item D, discuss and take action and setting a quarterly joint workshop for the Board of Commissioners and the Planning Commission, Commissioner Burks.
At the last Planning Commission meeting, I believe it was Mr. Viotta asked if we could perhaps set up a quarterly meeting between the Planning Commission and the Board of Commissioners. We had one recently, which I felt was very positive. I think going forward, it'd be good to have that meeting on a semi-regular basis, so that everyone can kind of be on the same track as to what the plan is for the city, and so we don't have any miscommunications. That's the idea behind that.
Okay. Any suggestions on how would you like to do something like that before a commission meeting, or do it a separate day and time for there's no time restrictions?
My suggestion would be to probably meet before the Planning Commission meetings once a quarter, just because there's nine of them versus five of us. It might be easier to, we know where those nine people are going to be on that day. If we can appear at once every 4 months, it's probably doable, I would think. It would maybe start at 6.
Okay. Commissioner Crutcher, Vice Mayor Crutcher.
Thank you. Well, and the other thing is on the Planning Commission night, there's already two members of this board present, so it's really just three of us that need to get here. So it does make more sense, to, if we're going to do this, to do it on the night that the Planning Commission has a meeting.
Okay. Go ahead.
Did you say quarterly, or did you say every 4 months?
I'm sorry, I think quarterly, so every 3 months.
Okay.
It's been a long day.
No, I get you.
Okay. Well, I don't know, are we going to need a motion to do this? We just direct you to advertise, so if everybody's kind of, anybody want to give any other input? What do you think, it may be February and do, you know, set calendar in the year?
For ease of purpose, we could just do the first meeting of each quarter, which would be January, April, July, October.
Okay.
Set it up that way and we could put that schedule out and we would have that on our books. We would just notify everyone out in advance that that would be what we would do. That's the easiest.
I know it's short notice to say, hey, y'all show up next Tuesday when y'all weren't necessarily planning on it. Do we want to start it not this quarter but the following perhaps? Or I'll be there anyway, so I'm good either way.
Which would be the meeting in July?
Yes.
We could start it then and that would be fine. That gives us into fiscal year. And there will also be some discussion about the training schedule, which we discussed yesterday, to try and make sure we have that. So that may be a good meeting to make sure everyone's on the same page, City Council and Planning Commission, as far as the expectations for the second half of the year, first half of the fiscal year.
Okay, sounds good. Any other? Yes.
I'm actually good with, if there's enough, I don't know how much time we have to advertise, but I'm good with this, going ahead and starting that now, if we have enough time.
Well,
there is already a meeting scheduled. Did y'all just got invitations, I guess, the emails? Didn't I spread an email about the joint? We were invited to the joint Planning Commission workshop, which is next Tuesday. So
it's 6 o'clock.
At 6.
Not the 11th or the 18th, I'm sorry.
The
11th. 11th, okay. I'd just like to see that start happening sooner than later. As far as I'm concerned.
Yeah, and I think we will with this one. It's I don't remember what the topic was. It was just more to start going over some of the
I believe the joint workshop that the board is invited to is to go over the land use map and the importance thereof. And again, I'm happy if everyone can come to that. I think they should. I know it's not always going to be possible, especially on short notice, but
We can certainly advertise it as a work session taking place on that day, and you can attend. So if you want to do the 11th, certainly can.
And I believe it's already been advertised as a joint workshop anyway.
But getting to schedule start in July would be perfect. I mean,
we'll take care of that.
Okay.
There.
Yes.
Mayor, if I may, the representative for 10A and 10B just walked in. I moved to reconsider item 10A and 10B.
What do we just, if he gets a motion or gets a second, we can open it back up?
Yeah, if you get a second, then if it passes board.
Okay. Anybody? Any seconds?
I'll second.
Okay, we have a first and second to reopen. So we'll just move back up to item A.
You need to vote on it.
Go on.
No, you need to vote on
it. Oh, vote on it. Yeah. Okay, got a first and second. Any discussion? Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Opposed?
Nay.
Nay.
Okay. It passes, so we'll go back to 10A, discuss and take action on ordinance number 2017-04.
An ordinance to change the zoning of certain property in the city of Fairview, Tennessee, located off Old Nashville Road, owned by Jennifer Rose Buford, Rita Olivia Kidder, and James Ricky Jones, as shown on Williamson County Tax Map 42. Parcel 74, Map 42, Parcel 79, and Map 22, Parcel 167, from RS 40 to RS 15, RPUD.
Well, I'm glad you're here.
Sorry, I was late. I got stuck in traffic getting out of Nashville, so
yeah.
Took me a little longer than I thought today.
Okay, well, we just had a few questions, so if will you go ahead and explain what you're wanting to do?
They are proposing a 39-lot subdivision. It is R15 PUD. And they, we feel like, they feel like that it's, that product that they're wanting to build there is very high in demand and for Fairview right now. So that's, that's what they're wanting to do.
Okay. And when you went in front of the planning commission, were y'all gonna meet all of the engineer's recommendations and, yeah, were you asking for any variances?
To be honest, I'm gonna have to fill me in on what those were because I had to leave the room, so I'm not sure what those were.
The representative said y'all would.
Well, if he said we will, then we will. If he said we will, then we will.
Okay. Go ahead.
Thank you, Mayor. Yeah, I'm looking at the notes from the planning commission meeting, and it looks like that question was asked, and the representative said that there were no requests for any variances. Mr. Beata did ask about a landscape buffer, rather, for lots 3, 2, 1, 29, and 28 back up to the main road, and asked about if there had been any discussion about that as to with respect to the landscape design. The representative that night stated that he wasn't aware of any. The setback was established, I think, that it was 20 feet. And Mr. Beata had simply asked that there be a detailed landscape buffer plan when it comes back. Now, I don't know if that meant comes here or comes back to the Planning Commission. Do you know, Mr. Ringer?
That probably be either on preliminary or construction phase back to the planning. But I personally think the better way to handle that, and I actually have talked to the engineer about that, is face those houses on Old Nashville to Old Nashville instead of letting them back up to Old Nashville and let them have rear entry garages. I think that'd be a lot more aesthetically pleasing to everyone going up and down Old Nashville. The driveways would not come out on Old Nashville, would put rear entry garages.
So my follow-up question based on that would be, I guess, to Mr. Cantrell and maybe Mr. Owen. In light of the fact that this is being presented as a PUD, if we approve it without, if that's what the developer's saying he would prefer to do, if we approve it without that change and something changes between here and going back to the Planning Commission, are we stuck with what we approved tonight?
I'd make it be clear in the record that it's contingent upon that change being placed on the PUD and the PUD restrictions, that it be actually made before it goes.
Okay. Mr. Owen?
With the PUD process, it's no different than a rezoning. And so, as you're aware, any rezoning that is applied for has to first be considered by the Planning Commission, and they offer you a recommendation. You take that recommendation under advisement, and you can then proceed as you desire to either add additional restrictions, take away what the Planning Commission recommended, or do whatever you want to from that point. So if you desire to make that tweak as a part of your consideration and approval, then that can certainly be done without having to go back to the Planning Commission if you desire. What I would suggest, if you do want to make any changes from what's before you, is that obviously you need to see those changes before you have your second and final reading. Would be my suggestion. While the Planning Commission can get into some contingency approval recommendations, knowing that there are additional steps that would require some revised submittals to be placed in the city's hands prior to final approval. Once you read and vote to approve at the second reading the rezoning, then that's done. So you need to make sure everything's buttoned up as you desire when you're voting on that second final reading spot.
And Mr. Owen, Alternatively, we could refer it, I assume, back to the Planning Commission. Is that correct or
not? You could.
To make sure those changes are made and approved by the, that it gets a positive recommendation from the Planning Commission at that point, based upon those changes.
You could, if you chose to. That would be somewhat of an atypical process, but...
Okay. And I guess that's my question. Is that atypical? That's not what would normally happen.
It would be, yeah. Now, if there's something majorly drastic that completely changes, you know, if you go from, you know, if you went from, say, a 20-lot subdivision to a 50-lot subdivision and you completely changed the lot sizes that were being proposed, something like that, then that might could be challenged to say, you know, the Planning Commission, that is a significant change and a material change in what the Planning Commission reviewed and recommended upon. But something as far as, you know, we want to see four of the houses faced in a different direction, I would contend that would not meet a threshold of requiring the Planning Commission to re-review or re-recommend something of that nature.
If, Mr. Mangum, if you change those five lots to where the houses are facing the road, how far will they be? The setback won't be 20 feet at that point. It'd be further back than that, right? Or is it still the same setback?
No, the front setback... Front's 35.
Okay.
Now, looking at this, I don't know how that discussion came up in the Planning Commission because I had left the room. I don't know how that even came into play because my intent all along was to face those towards Old Nashville because it looked odd go down the street and everything's facing Old Nashville and you get to a little section, there's five houses turn around backwards. That'd just be odd. So we would keep the driveways to those houses in the subdivision. They don't back out into Old Nashville. They go into the new proposed street.
Hey, I move to approve contingent upon lots 3, 2, 1, 29, and 28 facing Old Nashville Road and that being presented on second read in the plan.
And if it's okay, I would suggest that just be addressed in a note on the plan that says, you know, these residential structures on these five lots will have front facades facing Old Nashville Road with rear entry garages off of the proposed new subdivision streets. One point of clarity, the current master development plan shows 20-foot setbacks for both front and rear. So if you desire to push those back from Old Nashville Highway, which I would recommend because all the adjacent properties and probably across the street all have that 35-foot setback, and I think you'll still have a building envelope that is suitable for a structure. So that might be something you might want to consider.
Has my motion got a second yet?
No.
Well,
no.
Let me withdraw it and change it, and that'd be easier, I think. Well, I think there needs to be a motion first. And Mr. Owen, you may have to help me through this. So my motion would be that lots 3, 2, 1, 29, and 28, there be a note reflected on the plan on second read that those lots will be forward-facing or facing Old Nashville Road, and that the setback for those lots will be 35 feet.
The setback from Old Nashville Road would be 30.
That's
a minimum
right.
of 35
Front
feet.
Setback would be Front. 35 feet.
Second.
Okay, we have first and second. I kind of, is it necessary to go ahead and restate because of, you know, I feel a little burned from Cumberland, so you know where all this
sure.
is going. Is it necessary to say, and we won't all, you know, right now, whatever engineer recommendation and, you know, that there's no variances at this point?
You could do that. There were only, I think, three outstanding comments. Comment number one would certainly still be applicable. And comments two and three were more informative, I guess, in nature, as opposed to an actual applicable comment of requiring a revision to the plan, so to speak. But by all means, to keep it simple, if you want to say to incorporate, you know, the required changes.
Well, it just seems like everything's coming in front of us, our PUDs. And so I want to make sure, as a Board of Commissioners, that we don't make a mistake. So if we get in the habit, we know if we need to say it now or later, but that's what I want.
And the only other thing I might mention, there was one, I guess, additional slight variance that was briefly touched upon, and that would be the sidewalk requirement on along Old Nashville Road. As you guys may be aware, your current subregs require that a new sidewalk be placed on existing roads that front or a part of a new subdivision. So that is currently not being proposed in the master plan, and just wanted to make sure that everyone was aware of that as a part of the record. So.
Go
ahead.
Would that not conflict with the statement made that they were not asking for any variances, however?
Potentially. I don't specifically recall that conversation or that part of the discussion. And I apologize for that.
Well, and that's another thing that needs to be brought up. We made, you know, somebody on Horton Tavern put sidewalks when there was no. So I think we need to be consistent. And if that wasn't caught in the Planning Commission, then it needs to be considered.
Can I throw one thing out on that? Mm-hmm. I wasn't part of that conversation at the Planning Commission, but unless there's some future, relatively soon future plans for sidewalks along Old Nashville, and I know this has been talked about in Planning Commission or in staff for quite some time, and I seen the one on Horn Tavern, it's an eyesore. I mean, I would rather figure out what that footage is and what it would cost me and start a sidewalk fund and give the money to the city to go into a sidewalk fund to where those sidewalks, it's not going to be used across those five lots by very few people, to where they could be put in a place that more people would actually use them.
Go ahead.
Mayor, if I may, I agree with Mr. Mayor on this point. On Horn Tavern, when you've got a sidewalk, and I know that's what the regs require, but to have a sidewalk across four houses, the sidewalk to nowhere, essentially, it makes no sense whatsoever, and it looks ridiculous. We need to consider this seriously going forward about when you have this small number of houses that are actually going to be on the road, to put a sidewalk in front of them in lieu of doing that, like Mr. Mayor said, allow them to pay into a sidewalk fund similar to what you would in the tree fund, you know, to be used in other places where it makes more sense for there to be sidewalks. I think that's a very good point and something we need to consider. But I do have a question since I have the floor.
Okay.
When it came to the Planning Commission, it was approved with the staff report, and that wasn't part of my motion. So I don't know if we need to amend the motion to include the staff report or not. Mr. Collins.
I just have a question related specific to the sidewalks being discussed. It's my understanding that prior to this meeting, the homes were going to face inward into the neighborhood, and the back of the homes were going to face Old Nashville. And in that instance, no sidewalks would have been constructed on Old Nashville. So the discussion of sidewalks being installed on Old Nashville at this point wouldn't seem to be a point of variance, because you're still installing sidewalks on the interior street or drive. It is, I understand it. You would still install sidewalks as you would before. You just simply turn the home with no change to the sidewalks.
Yeah, I'm still a little bit confused on how the conversation went to where the house was going to be turned around backwards in the first place. That was never my intent. Maybe, I don't know how that came up.
Yeah, go ahead.
Mr. Mayor, just so I can clarify. So even if, if it was presented as you thought it was supposed to be, that the fronts are going to be facing Old Nashville Highway, the driveway will not actually connect to Old Nashville Highway. That's correct.
That's correct.
And they would actually go into a feeder road.
Yes.
And that feeder road would have sidewalks.
Correct.
So that takes care of the issue of sidewalks.
Yeah, they're on both sides of the road, best I know. That's according to subdivision regs.
That's right.
Okay. So that would clarify that issue. And I have another question for our city engineer, just so we can clarify for the citizens. Our current land use map, what is this actually considered? Medium, high, low density?
The RS-15 designation, density designation, is defined in your current zoning ordinance as a medium density residential development.
And going to this PUD, is that fit appropriately in a medium density area?
Yes. This PUD is based on an RS-15 density calculation, which is defined as a medium density residential density. And this particular parcel is identified on the land use map as a medium density residential parcel. Does that answer your question?
It does. And okay. I just think it's important for the citizens to know that this does conform with our land use map.
Yes. There are no changes that are required to your land use map as a result of this proposed density. It matches the proposed density that was decided upon by not these members, or not your current members of the Planning Commission, but the Planning Commission members at the time that that current map was adopted, I think in 2012, I believe. So.
Okay, did you need to add anything? Are you happy with your motion?
Well, we needed to add the same that came out of the Planning Commission, that it would be approved with the, I think it's got staff comments on it. Approved with staff comments and the other contingencies that I've already mentioned. We'll go back through those.
Mayor?
Yes.
I also note in the recommendations from the Planning Commission that Chairman Butler suggested it go back to the Tree Commission. Did it go back to the Tree Commission for the landscape approval?
Who? Brandon?
Mm-hmm.
Mr. Butler, come on, join us. We're long. We're going to have everybody standing up here.
You had asked that Mr. Hall take it back to the Tree Commission for the landscaping approval. Did it go back?
Commissioner Rennie, I think, and that note might have been pertaining if there was a buffer added, and so it would meet the approved species list. Would it be approved trees for the required buffer area? And then it may have also pertained to any kind of construction entrance. If there's a construction entrance, do the plantings around the construction entrance meet the approved list and things like that? So the tree board visited, or the city arborist visited, would have been my recommendation.
Okay. Were you done?
Did that happen?
Mr. Butler, with the change of fixing it back to where it was supposed to be, with the houses facing the road, there's no need for that landscape buffer, so it wouldn't need to go back to the tree board commission because of that.
I hate to speak for everyone, but I think the intended would be correct. That would be correct. Yes, sir.
Okay. And Commissioner Rainey, are you sure I didn't cut you off?
It's good.
Okay. Okay. Any other questions? Comments?
One thing I feel, okay, I might be remiss if I didn't mention it. If I understand the thought process tonight, your decision on moving on the sidewalks along Old Nashville Road, the thought process of why you would not require them is because there would be no driveways that would be connected to Old Nashville Road. That would set a precedent, and as long as you're okay with that precedent, then that would be fine. And I'm not aware of any recent development in the recent past, in the past maybe 12 to 24 months, that would meet this specific criteria in which someone could say, well, I didn't get that consideration. I know Cumberland Estates had, I believe, two of their five or six frontage lots that had access from the internal roads of the subdivision, but the remainder of the frontage of those lots had driveways accessing directly onto Cumberland Drive. So that would not be apples to apples, but I do want you to understand the potential ramifications of not requiring a sidewalk or some type of funding in lieu of sidewalk in this specific application would potentially set a precedent for future PUDs.
Mr. Owen, let me ask you. So Cumberland, they're doing the same thing. Those driveways are not, they're coming out on the road, or is it coming in from behind?
There's a mix on Cumberland, and I don't have that plan in front of me, but my best recollection is at least two of those, of their frontage lots on Cumberland would be accessed by a secondary road within the new subdivision. There are, I think, three, maybe four lots in that Cumberland Estates that would have a direct driveway and access onto Cumberland Drive. So in that regard, that development would have some lots that did have driveways onto the existing street, and therefore sidewalks were required and improvements are intended for Cumberland Drive.
Okay, thank you.
That would be the distinction between that one and this one. This one has zero lots that would access the existing street from a driveway perspective.
Well, and I think that's going to be the key is we are going to I mean, I hate to go down this path because I know we have required people to put sidewalks to nowhere. And it's scary to me to sit here and say, okay, you don't have to, you do. If there's a problem with that, then we need to revisit what we're asking to do. But if we can justify the fact of this is different because of the feeder road, then, you know, that is our statement. But it does scare me not requiring everybody. I think everybody should have to do what they're supposed to do. Commissioner Rainey has something, and I'll come back to you.
Can this board establish a sidewalk fund like the tree fund? I mean, can we do that? And how would we, I mean, I know we can, but then how would we, because the tree fund, there's a definite schedule and there's a definite formula that we use to decide how much that is. So how would we do that for a sidewalk fund, and how would we do that tonight? I'm assuming it seems like it.
There is kind of something that. Well, Mr. Hall, did you want to explain?
I'd just like to address Commissioner Rainey. There is already a fee schedule for sidewalk fund, so that can be achieved.
Okay, yes.
I guess my concern here would be, it is silly, I think, to have a sidewalk that no one's going to use, but there's nothing on either side. It's just kind of there. And it's not really usable, except by maybe some wildlife. But at the same time, if this area gets developed on either side and we require them to put sidewalks, we now have a gap. Instead of having a sidewalk fund, can we do a sidewalk bond? Say, here's what it would cost for this specific area, and require that it be kept for a certain period of time, such that if these other developments, say another development comes in on either side, we can say, okay, let's put it into effect and have the money specifically to build sidewalks in that area to cover that gap. I don't know if that's the same thing or not.
Okay. Commissioner.
Thank you, Mayor.
Vice Mayor.
The way I analyze all of these requests are, is the developer meeting what our codes, our regulations require them to meet? That's what I want to know. And what I'm hearing is, and they're not asking for any variance. And what I'm hearing is that if we have a forward-facing house, a house facing the main road with a rear entry drive, that there's nothing in our regulations that require a sidewalk. And if that's the case, then I don't even understand this discussion. I don't understand why we're putting that, if it's not required by what's in writing. And I want everybody to play by the same rules. But the rules are the rules. And if it's not the rules, then I don't understand where we're going with this.
Well, besides wasting a little bit of time, I think with the first PUD and these conversations as a board, we need to understand what we're voting on. And, you know, and since he is making a change, we needed clarification. So,
Oh, I'm fine with having the discussion, Mayor. I mean, I just don't understand the thinking behind it, because what I've heard the city manager say earlier is there's no reason for a variance. So unless somebody says otherwise, and maybe Will has something he can.
The current language in the subregs, 4-104.2, sidewalks along existing streets. It's one sentence. Sidewalks shall be required along the proposed subdivision's frontage on existing public streets. It makes no differentiation between which way the house
well,
is from.
That clears things up.
Now, I guess the point of my rambling discussion previously was, if you want to set a distinction by the course of your decision tonight for this specific application, to set that distinction on forward-facing or, I guess, access on existing streets, you can do that. But you would be setting a precedent, not to say you couldn't break that precedent, but it could be challenged. And quite frankly, I don't know that it's a bad precedent, because one of the things that we are challenged with is multiple ingress egress points on existing city streets that may or may not have some may or may not be relatively newer or up to current standard streets. And so when you have maybe potentially an incentive for a developer to reduce the number of new driveways along an existing road, that's not a bad thing necessarily. So the precedent of saying, hey, Mr. Developer, we've made a distinction that if you will not have any new driveways onto this existing street and only have the new subdivision road as the new as an access point on the existing street for this entire frontage of the development, then we will give consideration based on historical decisions to not require you to either put a sidewalk fund in place or to put sidewalks that lead to nowhere. So it's not necessarily a bad precedent to set. I hope I can educate you on what the pros and cons of that precedent might be for the future.
Is that a request that the developer has to make in terms of, based off of what you just read to me, it's not, I mean, it sounds like that it is a requirement.
It is.
And so they're going to have to ask for some variance from what's in our rules and regs. I understand what you're saying. I agree that I don't think it's a bad precedent based off of what we know has happened in the past. But at the same time, I want to make sure that we're doing it correctly.
Yeah, and that's part of the beauty of a PUD is that variances from the black and white of the book somewhat go away and are become a part of the PUD approval. So there would not be a requirement for this specific variance to say go before the BZA, because a PUD is just that document that creates that flexibility of the give and take that the Board of Commissioners has in providing for different restrictions from what the base underlying zone. For instance, you know, your RS-15, your straight RS-15 zone requires a minimum lot size of 15,000 square feet. Well, the minimum lot sizes in this development, there's several that are around 7,500 square feet. So that's not necessarily a variance. That's just part of the PUD process and what they're requesting. So,
okay. Mr. Hall, you said there was already something in place that establishes how you determine what would be paid into a sidewalk fund. Can you
May I offer two things? I would caution the board at this point against making decision regarding a sidewalk fund, simply because sidewalks themselves are highly regulated, ADA and otherwise, and they come with their own sets of liability. And specific to a sidewalk fund and the use of that, I would encourage some additional work and research to make sure that we comply with everything we need to comply with specific to a sidewalk fund. Clearly the board can do that, but I would certainly be careful moving forward with that, just as a point of caution to make sure we don't miss anything in that process. Secondly, the discussion about the sidewalks and only was from me that if these homes were built with the back of the homes facing Old Nashville Road, then it would have been somewhat out of place to have sidewalks along privacy fences along Old Nashville Road to get to the entrance of that when clearly the sidewalks would have been installed inside the subdivision. Regardless of the requirement that you have, I certainly would caution, I would certainly make sure that we do some significant homework on the sidewalks as a part of the proposal. It'd be my only.
Well, here's where I was going with my thinking, and I agree with what you're saying. And I want to know more about it before I wouldn't vote tonight to do something like that.
Because
I mean, we don't even know what the formula is or anything like that. But I don't remember if it was Commissioner Burch or somebody made a good point earlier. And again, I don't know what's beside. I'm looking at the map. It looks like there's a pretty large parcel to, if you're looking at this development, a pretty large parcel to the left. It's about 23 acres. And then a single family home to the right. So I don't know if there will ever be other development there or not. But if we're going to establish a precedent that if these roads are facing, I mean, these houses rather are facing the road with rear entry drives, that we're not going to require a sidewalk at all, and then there's future development on either side of it that would require a sidewalk, then like Commissioner Burks, or I don't remember who said it, you're going to have a gap there, which was where I was going with the idea of paying into the sidewalk fund, where if and when that occurred, we could go in as a city and attach that.
Absolutely.
Now, I'm not prepared to do that tonight, obviously, because we don't know what that formula is and don't have any other information about that. But that is a concern. Mr. Mangum, to move this forward, what are your thoughts on putting sidewalks?
Well,
in? Even though it,
you know, I heard a discussion earlier about we've required it here and not here. You know, if you want to compare an apple to an apple, then in previous cases, you have had driveways that used existing road. Now, if I were to face these houses towards Old Nashville and propose to exit on Old Nashville, as soon as this gets rezoned, if I'm not mistaken, I can get my permits because I'm on existing road. So that would actually speed me up. That helps me. That gets me 5 permits fairly quick with no infrastructure cost. But we are proposing to make these drives rear entry, no entry points onto Old Nashville except for the new feeder road. And every lot we have has a sidewalk on it. May not be in the front of it across Old Nashville, but they're in the back of it. So, you know, it's, yeah, the Cumberland Estates, maybe we required them there, but they're using the existing road. The deal on Horn Tavern, same scenario. Yeah, they were required, but they're backing out in the middle of Horn Tavern Road. You know, I think we presented a fairly nice product here. You know, and the rest is up to y'all. I mean, I think what we've done is a fairly nice layout that works well for the city. And again, I'm not sure how the conversation come up about the houses being turned backwards.
Well, I did want to, we do have a sidewalk fund, it's not a fund, but where they have to pay. So that's already existing. So tonight, if we are moving forward and he's turning around and we haven't changed anything in our codes, then technically he does as he recommended, he'd rather donate than have to, then we probably need to consider that, because we are still giving a variance from our code. Unless you want to tell me something different, Will. That's no, how I see.
No, I was just reading the specific section on the sidewalk fund, and I'll give you a minute to think while I read it. But developers and the Planning Commission may reach alternative arrangements concerning sidewalks where strict compliance with the provisions of this section would be unfair or cause an undue hardship due to previously approved plats and or development plans. Such alternative provisions may include 1, payment to a city fund for construction of the sidewalks by the city at this location at a later date, or 2, the actual construction of sidewalks at another location, which I would not recommend. In the absence of mutual agreement, the developer shall construct the sidewalks in the manner provided herein, which is on the site, the existing site in question. So, I mean, that's in place.
Mayor, okay. So it states unfair or causes a hardship?
Where the strict compliance with the provisions of this section would be unfair or cause an undue hardship due to previously approved plats and or development plans.
So that would not apply to this development?
That specific provision would not. But I don't know. I would recommend or suggest to you that that would not be a specific reason not to consider paying into the fund, if you feel it's of mutual benefit to both the city and the developer. Because I do think, as has previously been stated, sidewalks to nowhere are not only an eyesore for the time that they're floating out there in space, but they're also a maintenance requirement for your city crews, and not along with the liability of trips, slips, and falls that Mr. Larry, I'm certain, has many stories about. So all things to consider.
Okay. Any other thoughts? Go ahead.
I really think it would be easier, and I hate to do this, just to withdraw my original motion and restate this motion. So I guess we'd have to have a second to withdraw my original motion, but we can. All right. My motion is to approve this project with the February 13th, 2017 city staff report with lots 3, 2, 1, 29, and 28 facing Old Nashville Road with rear entry drives, with money to be paid into the fund. The sidewalk fund is already established and determined based on the existing formula, which will be presented before second read.
And the 35-foot setback from Old Nashville Road.
With 35-foot setbacks on Old Nashville Road. Sorry.
Can I get clarification on something before you get a second?
Okay.
Yes.
Now, this paying into that fund, is that to put a sidewalk here later or somewhere else?
Well, it's my proposal was to pay it in and as based on whatever the existing policy is in terms of the sidewalk fund. All I can do is make decisions based off the information that's provided. And the information that I'm told tonight is that there is an existing sidewalk fund, that there's an existing formula. I don't know what that, we're gonna have time to look at that between now and second read. I don't know what that policy says. I don't know if it says to put sidewalks where on your project or other places throughout the city. I don't know the answer to that.
My whole point in asking that, if it's to go here later, I put them in now. I mean, that's not going to make or break this deal. I mean, I put them in now.
Yes.
Well, I think the issue is we don't necessarily want them in now because it creates an eyesore because you just have a strip of sidewalk that's not usable, really going to be used. It requires a maintenance cost of the city to maintain that, make sure it stays ADA compliant. And if someone's walking on there and falls because there's a crack that we didn't see because it's a sidewalk no one ever uses, then we have some liability there. So it seems to make more sense from our standpoint to have it paid into the fund so that we can build it as needed if it becomes an issue we are connecting to something else. So it's just not a sidewalk to nowhere. It would then be a sidewalk to something or somewhere.
Mayor?
Yes, go ahead.
Didn't you read in the rules and regs that it to be placed there or somewhere else?
The payment into the fund for construction of the sidewalks by the city at this location at a later date, or the actual construction of sidewalks at another location. So I interpret that to mean the developer can pay into the fund for those sidewalks to be constructed at that location at a later date by the city, or the developer can install actual sidewalks at another location while this development's going on at a location that is agreed upon by the city and the developer. So I think that's a very poor option.
Well, I think that doesn't make sense. If he's required to put sidewalks wherever his other development would be, why? I mean, that sounds like the city, like the tree fund, that you have the right to put those trees where they may be needed. So the sidewalks would be put wherever they may be needed by the city's decision, not the developer building somewhere else. And that sounds kind of...
Correct. The other location would be a mutual agreed upon location by the applicant and the Board of Commissioners.
That does not make... I mean, that. So you're saying that if Mr. Mungram pays into the sidewalk fund,
mm-hmm.
and then... If the city decided to spend that sidewalk fund to build sidewalks on 100 somewhere.
This is saying you can't do that.
Okay, read it again, please.
Okay.
The whole thing.
Okay. Such alternative provisions may include, so that's an important word too, so you're not excluding other options. Number one, payment to a city fund for construction of the sidewalks by the city at this location at a later date. Or number two, the actual construction of sidewalks at another location.
By the city or the developer?
By the developer at an agreed upon alternative location between the city and the developer. I agree, it's poorly worded.
Yeah, it's confusing. I so get what you're questioning.
To shed a little light, that's a big, bold highlight in our current review of the sub-regs. So.
Because that doesn't make sense. I mean, it doesn't say the city or the developer. It sounds like that if the city needs to build sidewalks somewhere else, they can take that money and use it for that.
I agree.
So, yes.
Okay. Go ahead.
I know we've probably talked about sidewalks more than we ever have in our life. However, how long of a stretch of sidewalk are we talking here? Let's figure that out.
I want to say, without having a two-scale drawing with me,
rough estimate.
Around 300 to 325 feet.
Is there anywhere in the city we know that we need 325 square feet of sidewalk only? It doesn't really make sense to say, okay, I guess we could find a spot. Where do we need 300 feet? Where do we put 150 feet here? It would just seem to make more sense to pay into it. That kind of solves our problems. If we need to build it, we will. Then the question becomes, if we never do, what happens to that money? Does it state in the ordinance for the fund what happens to it?
I would defer to the city manager.
Yes, and he's ready.
May I offer a middle ground so we can take some action on this? If it would be amenable to the city, and if it will be amenable to Mr. Mangrum, and find some solution here. On the agenda that we have tonight, we are approving a contract for Safe Routes to Schools, which we all agree is a sidewalk project that is necessary. If it will be amenable to the city, take the amount of money that Mr. Mangrum would have used to install sidewalks along Old Nashville Road, take that value and apply it toward the city's cost of the Safe Routes to Schools project. That way we get the equivalent linear feet of sidewalk that that would prepare. That offsets the cost to the city, and it allows for a moving forward on this item. So we would all have an understanding of where that linear foot of sidewalk would apply.
I think that's a great suggestion, but it's still up to Mr. Mangrum whether or not he may still choose to put it in front of his subdivision.
Well,
or
my biggest question would be, and apparently nobody knows what the fee schedule is, and I'm sure my cost to put these in is a lot less than a fee schedule. So that's the unknown. Now, I could scale this tomorrow with a full set of plans, get my footage. Excuse me. Get with my concrete guy, see what that number is, and I'd be glad to do that. Whatever that number is, whether it be 2,000, 3,000, 4,000, whatever it is, I'm fine with what Mr. Collins is recommending. But if we don't know what the fee schedule is, and that makes me the slightest bit hesitant, because if I can do this for $3 a foot and y'all's fee is $10 a foot, well, guess what I want?
Can we get the schedule?
Well, I think Mr. Hall just is gone to get something for us, I would assume. But I mean, I think even with the motion that's on the floor, which we need a second for, you could word it as either he builds the sidewalks or pays in and it goes towards Safe Routes to School.
Well,
go ahead.
I apologize. But then we come back to the discussion we were having of, do we necessarily want one there? And that's the problem, I guess.
At a cost of $4 per linear foot, round figures, we're talking $2,400, a cost to the city in the future to install sidewalks along Old Nashville Road, or apply those dollars. And again, I haven't seen the formula. Mr. Manger mentioned $3 a foot. We're looking at $5 a foot, $4 a foot gets you. So you're somewhere $3,000 or less total scope, be it the city's cost or Mr. Mangrum's cost, regardless of the direction you apply the sidewalks.
Mayor, is the fee schedule not anywhere on the website with everything else? I mean, where do we have to find that?
Well, I'm sure it is. If somebody wants to look it up, I think Mr. Hall went to. Yeah.
I know it had been discussed several years ago, but I don't remember it ever going anywhere. But.
Well, for purposes of this item, I'm fine with stating in the motion that either he will pay based off of the existing fee schedule into the sidewalk fund to be used on the Safe Routes to School project, or put in sidewalks. I'm fine with it being an either or.
Well, Mayor, I mean, and here again, I agree with Commissioner Burks that we get into the thing, do we want the sidewalk there as a liability to the city? I mean, so we have that to look at.
Can we approve it as proposed by Mr. Crutcher, then at the second reading, grant a variance at that point if we want to? If we say, hey, you know what, the fee schedule is too high compared to what the actual construction cost would be, which would make Mr. Mangrum want to go ahead and do that, which I would understand, then we could say, well, we can go ahead and grant a variance then if we decide we want to do that at a second reading.
You can. It's fully amendable. It's like an ordinance. It's a special case of an ordinance. And it's like any other ordinance. It's fully amendable to the second reading unless there's such a drastic amendment to that, that it changes the scope of the ordinance. And that would not do that. I think you certainly could pass it either or, and then get your figures together, and when it comes back for second reading, you amend out what you don't want. Or amend in what you do, whichever way you want to look at it.
Then based upon that, I'll second Mr. Crutcher's motion so we can move this forward.
Okay, we have a first and second. Any more discussions? All in favor? Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries.
Thank you.
Well, stick around here.
Yeah, I'm not.
Okay, new business B, discuss and take action on resolution 03-17.
Resolution to set a public hearing for the purpose of obtaining public comment on changing the zoning and establishing PUD status of certain property in the city of Fairview, Tennessee, located off Old Nashville Road, owned by Jennifer Rose Buford, Rita Olivia Kidder, and James Ricky Jones, as shown on Williamson County Tax Map 42, Parcel 74, Map 42, Parcel 79, and Map 22, Parcel 167, from RS 40 to RS 15 residential PUD. Move to approve.
Second. First and second. Any other discussion?
Mayor?
Yes.
I know that at one point in time we discussed when we had these public hearings that we should open this up to people could send emails, they could send, that every sort of device of communication could be used rather than people having to actually physically appear here. I mean, is that something we could do?
I do think they can send emails and, you know, any way of communication to the public hearing. I mean, that's already, I mean, they can send us anything. Are you talking about announcing it or just the citizens that have it?
Do we need to? Yes, I mean, citizens that have comments to make, because, you know, we all know that sometimes it's not easy to get here. You've got baseball games and soccer games and kids in bed and homework, and it's not easy to get here.
Yeah, I mean, typically I think if somebody has a complaint, they'll email all of us is what normally happens. Now, we can make it a practice to read those, you know, into the discussion in the minutes, and that might be a good idea.
And maybe also remind people they can do that.
Yes.
That they're welcome to do that.
Okay, go ahead.
Mayor, I believe I've previously requested that when these things come to the board that they include the list of adjoining property owners with their contact information. I thought we were going to start doing that because, you know, we can, rely on them to show up. But again, they may not really know it's happening. So it may be beneficial for us to be able to call and contact those people to see if they do have an opinion on it. And I know they do provide that information. Can we get that out to the board members?
We can. I don't normally put it in the packet because I would have to redact all that information. So I'm happy to send it to you guys, but I do have it, and certified letters are sent to them. So I always have proof of what was received and picked up and what was not.
I understand. And I didn't think about the redaction issue, so I appreciate that. But if you could forward that to us so that we can contact them and just cover all our bases.
Okay. Vice Mayor.
I was just going to say that the property owners' names are listed in the packet, but we don't have addresses or phone numbers, so that's correct.
They're listed.
Yeah, the adjacent property owners are listed.
Yeah, they're listed on the form itself.
Yeah, the rezoning form.
Okay, I just missed it. But you do have their contact information as well.
Addresses.
Yeah. Okay.
Okay, so any other discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Opposed? Motion carries.
Thank you.
Okay, that will bring us back down to E, discuss and take action on ordinance number 2017-5. An ordinance to amend the City of Fairview, Tennessee Municipal Code, Title 7, Chapter 5, Section 7-501 through 7514, fireworks. Vice Mayor.
Thank you, Mayor. Sorry, I didn't pick up on reading the caption there.
That's okay.
I was thinking. This is something that we had talked about last meeting, and I had requested the city attorney to prepare the necessary documentation, the ordinance to change the language in the current existing ordinance so that fireworks could actually be sold. And I'd requested that it be specific to nonprofits, local nonprofits, which exist within the corporate boundaries of the city of Fairview, Tennessee, or exist or operate. And I have read what has been proposed, and I have a couple of questions. I guess let's start by, did you find anything, Mr. Cantrell, that would in any way limit our ability to put that restriction on who can sell within the corporate boundaries?
Mr. Vice Mayor, I did some lengthy research on this, and I will leave the results of citations with the city manager. And did I find anything that said you couldn't? Yes. It has been challenged, but it's my opinion from having read cases from the state of Tennessee and all across the country that to tell you that you wouldn't get some pushback from this would be less than true. Most of the ones, that's the reason the cases came out, there was pushback from it. But I think having read those cases and read the Tennessee statute, in particular, TCA 6-2-201, that statute in general, and particularly Section 22, that's part of your charter. It's state law that municipal boards are given a great deal of authority to regulate things that in the interest of safety and well-being for the cities. Most of the challenges that people came about was challenging constitutional grounds that it's an unconstitutional infringement on the right to do business. And the cases, and it's not particularly, some of them are about fireworks, but not all about fireworks, but it's about the principle that the city can say, if you want to limit the amount of fireworks, the days that fireworks are sold, you can completely ban it, obviously. This is under, it always comes to the policing power. It's not a zoning ordinance. It's not a zoning issue. If it was a zoning issue, back when the city decided to ban sale of fireworks in the city, they would have had a real problem because some of those stands, I understand, and I don't know this to be absolutely true, had been there for a long, long time. And under the grandfathering statute on the zoning, you get to keep what was there if it was brought in at that time. But this state and most other states have said that under the policing power, I think you would be correct in if you're going to do it to nonprofits, to not set a number, say 3, 4, or 5, although there was one instance where that was upheld. But I think you get a lot more pushback if you tried to limit the number than it did if you just say, anybody that's a nonprofit that can qualify with the requirements of the ordinance can come in and sell, because then if I bring a suit against you, you can say, if you want to do this, just form a nonprofit and come on in. I think you can do it, but to tell you that you wouldn't have some pushback, you may very well have some pushback, and you might even get sued over. But I think you could probably do it, and you certainly can limit the days. And what I was trying to do in constructing this ordinance, I wasn't trying to read the board's mind. I put some dates in there around July the 4th and around Christmas and New Year's, and certainly this ordinance, like any other ordinance, would be capable of being amended up until the second reading. And if amendments were enough, you might have to delay the second reading. But I think you could certainly do it. Would it be greatly popular? I don't know. Mr. Cantrell, with all due respect, I have no idea whether we should or shouldn't do this based off of that. I mean, I'll be honest. I mean, if it's something that's going to be challenged, I'm not interested in putting us in a position to be challenged. I mean, we've got enough things going on that we don't need to create
even the potential for litigation. If this is something that's going to create somebody coming in here that wants to sell fireworks that is that's a for-profit company, and they're going to, they decide they want to challenge this in some form or fashion, I'm not interested in going down that road, quite frankly. So I think that where that leaves me with this is, okay, do we just leave it status quo and just not allow it at all, which really doesn't make a lot of sense since we allow the shooting of fireworks, because we have people that are driving across the county line to buy fireworks, and of course we don't share in any of that revenue as a city. Or do we just open it up across the board? And if we open it up across the board, let me ask this question, and please just yes or no as best you can. I know in law there's not always a yes or no, but if we limit the number of permits that could be issued, if it could be issued to anybody, not just nonprofits, but for-profits as well, should we limit the number of permits that could be issued on an annual basis, or would that be a bad idea as well?
My answer in a question in one word? No.
Yes. Okay. All right. That good enough.
But let me add something else. As I said this on the other thing, it's been tried all across the country and it's been largely successful. But if they got pushed back in Arkansas, Tacoma, Washington, Washington, D.C., Fort Worth, Texas, and Alabama. So, you know, they were, in most instances, ultimately successful, but they got a chance to defend it.
So here's my position on this, then. Again, I think those are our two options, leave the status quo or just open it up altogether for anyone that wants to come in here and do that. And that's bothersome to me. I hate to do that, because what we're going to have is my idea was for this to be a means for some of these local nonprofits that are all trying to collect money from a relatively small pool every year to be able to do something as a fundraiser, such as sell fireworks, that I think would be very lucrative to numerous nonprofits if they could get a tent set up to do it. Now what you're going to have, we open up to everybody, is you're going to have local nonprofits that are going to be competing with these for-profit companies that are going to come in, and they're going to make deals with these commercial areas for the best spots in town, you know, and why wouldn't, it's just good business. If I own, you know, the BP up here right at the four lanes, why wouldn't I make a deal to collect, you know, get a percentage of your sales? I mean, it just makes good business sense, whereas nonprofits are not going to have that luxury. The idea was is for these local business owners to donate their property or space for you, the local nonprofit, to be able to make some money in lieu of that business having to donate money to multiple teams or multiple organizations that are wanting to collect money throughout, you know, the year. But with that said, if we're going to allow fireworks to be shot, I think we should allow fireworks to be sold. And in light of that, then what I would like to do is remove the restriction based off of your legal advice, remove the restriction that it be only limited to nonprofits and open it up to where fireworks can be sold as they were previous to the ban. So my motion would be to approve this with the amendment that it be available to anyone that requests a permit.
Okay. Commissioner Burks has something to say.
Mr. Cantrell, no offense, but listening to you earlier reminded me of my full day with the Department of Children's Services, hearing that explanation. With the case law that you've researched, I understand you searched across the nation, but specifically as to Tennessee, did you find a case on point where it was limited to nonprofits in the state of Tennessee to sell fireworks?
Not necessarily applied to just fireworks, no.
Did you find a case where the selling of some other item was limited to nonprofits for a fundraising purpose in the state of Tennessee?
No, it's basically on limiting the numbers.
I'm sorry?
Basically on limiting the numbers of people that could participate.
Okay. So specifically, there's not been a case challenged in the state of Tennessee where a municipality said, we'll open up the sale of a certain item to nonprofits only?
No.
Okay. So that's actually never been challenged to anyone's knowledge in Tennessee?
There was... the Massengale case was pretty well applicable to that, but it's not exactly on point.
Okay. Based on, and I apologize, I haven't had a chance to read that site. I would prefer to, if possible, that we continue to limit this to nonprofits. And what I'm hearing is that there's really not been a challenge to that in the state of Tennessee. I know you said we could get some pushback, but quite frankly, we can get pushback on just about anything that we do here. And I've stated before, my goal for 2018 is to have no new lawsuits, so that's really my goal. However, I think this is a very good idea to allow our citizens to be able to buy fireworks here in the city instead of going outside the city limits and giving money to the county or some other county. And I still think it's a great idea to use it as a fundraising vehicle for nonprofits at the same time. And what I'm hearing is it's really not been challenged, so we may get some pushback, but it's never been challenged here.
No, there's not that specific issue. Fireworks issues, yes, but not that specific issue, no.
And the ones you saw, it sounds like just when you said we only allow 5 vendors to come in, that's kind of where the issues came in.
Yeah, when they were trying to limit the number of vendors, I think you'd be in a much better shape if you said, you know, if I don't like it, go form my own nonprofit and bring it in.
Okay. All right, so as long as we don't limit the number of nonprofits, it sounds like we're probably fine.
I think you probably would win, but I think you may have the opportunity because it seems to be something that there's enough interest in for some people to find out if they can do it or not.
There's a motion on the table. I second the vice mayor's motion. Any more discussion?
What is the motion?
You want to state it again?
Motion to approve the amended ordinance, but to not limit it to nonprofits, to open it up to where anyone can come in and sell based off of the legal advice we received. And again, if I may, this is first read. I mean, there's some things I want to, if we did decide before second read to amend this to make it just applicable to nonprofits, then I would want to, there's some language that I think we need to look at in here about how that's defined. And again, I know Mr. Cantrell was drafting it with not really much instruction, so.
I was trying to get you something to start on.
Right.
And I knew that.
Yeah.
But something to start with is better than.
That's right.
Than I think.
This will move it forward. And I guess my question would be, and I think I understand the difference maybe. Well, one, on the cases that you've looked at, what's the cause of action that they have?
Violation of constitutional law.
Which, equal protection? What is it?
The basically that unreasonable restraint on trade.
Okay. And you're saying that in this instance, it would be an unreasonable restraint on trade because this isn't part of the zoning, whereas I guess in terms of a zoning standpoint, we can limit the number of liquor stores, we can limit the number of certain things or place where certain things go, but because that's part of zoning, it's not susceptible to challenge, whereas this is not part of zoning, so therefore it is susceptible to challenge.
Right, but where you see the challenges come on zoning is where something was in existence, say in the county, and you annexed it. And they say, well, I can keep operating under the grandfather clause because you can't, if I was here before, was legally operating, well, and you rezone it, I mean, you annex it. But what they're saying here is that it's under the policing power that you can say you can have them or you can't have them.
Well, that's not what I'm talking about.
You can zone where the business is going to be conducted.
Right. But for instance, under current zoning, I think our municipality allows 3 package stores.
And yes.
If I recall correctly. So I'm not talking about if there's one existing, then we annex it in and us say, no, you can't exist anymore. Obviously, they would be grandfathered in. I get that. That's not what I'm talking about. But if another package store wanted to come in here, they couldn't challenge the fact that we only, it's restriction on trade, but we're limited into 3. They couldn't challenge that restriction because it's part of zoning, whereas
nope. Which,
okay.
What they would do is say it's an unreasonable restraint on trade, violation of the Constitution.
Well, that's what I'm trying to understand. If I want to open a liquor store, and I can make that argument, and that's, to my knowledge, that's never been challenged here.
No,
I mean, we've got that restriction.
The ones that were unsuccessful in here were the ones that tried to challenge it on that basis, that you couldn't tell how many could be there. In other words, they said it was not an unreasonable restraint on trade, that you're policing for the safety of the people there. You say I'm going to have four, I can have as many as wants to come in there.
Okay, here's what I want to do. I want to remove my motion and defer this.
Second.
Okay, well, I have to remove the second. Okay, can I get a motion to defer?
Motion to defer.
Second.
Second.
Okay, any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Motion carries. F, discuss and take action on ordinance number 2017-06.
An ordinance to amend the City of Fairview, Tennessee Municipal Code Title 14, Zoning and Land Use Control, Chapter 1, Municipal Planning Commission, Section 14-101, Creation and Membership, and Title 14, Zoning and Land Use Control, Chapter 1, Municipal Planning Commission, Section 14-103, Removal for Cause.
Move to approve.
Second.
Got a first and second. Discussion. Go ahead, Vice Mayor.
Mayor, if I may, thank you. There were three things. We've talked about this a lot over the past month and a half, 2 months. And as a result of a workshop that we had a month and a half ago or so, there were three concerns that I heard over and over. One was how we handle recusals, and there's an ordinance that we'll talk about next that deals with that. The other was the educational hours required of our planning commission, and the third was absences. And then a fourth part of that, from what I recall from our last discussion and looking at the minutes, is about term limits. And, you know, I've thought a lot about this ordinance and those things that I put forward last time, and I put most of those forward because those were the concerns I heard, and I wanted to move something forward on this issue instead of us just continuing to talk about it over and over and over. However, after much reflection specifically about the term limits and in discussion with the Planning Commission, the new Planning Commission chairman, and we've had some correspondence with him, I've thought a lot about that particular part of this ordinance. And, you know, I completely am still on board with putting to a vote on a referendum to the citizens term limits for this board, and I think that's appropriate, and I'll stand behind that decision and that position. But with this board in particular, I understand now, after further discussion and further thought, the importance of having some established experience on that board, and that continuing for a significant period of time, or being there to draw upon over more than maybe what the term limit that I'm proposing is. The other thing about this is all of these members on this board, or this commission rather, they're on 3-year terms. So every 3 years they have to reapply for their position, and it comes to this board for a vote. So if at any given time after that term is up, they present an application and we feel like, for whatever reason as a board, or whoever is here, feels like that, you know, they're not doing the job that was expected of them as a Planning Commission member, then we have the ability to remove that person. And it only takes 3 votes to accomplish that. So in light of that, I prefer to take out the term limits for the Planning Commission. The rest of the things that we talked about, the 6 hours instead of 4 for the educational requirement, and the absences, 2 instead of 3, 2 consecutive absences are 25% of the Planning Commission meetings within a calendar year, which essentially is 3 absences over the course of a calendar year. I'm for those, but I personally would like to remove the term limit requirement after a lot of deliberation, a lot of discussion about why it's really important for this board to have some consistency. And if you get good members that have a lot of experience to draw on, and it to me, it makes no sense to get rid of those people. Like I said, because we're the ones that holds the cards when they reapply anyway. We can decide what to do at that point based off the information that we have. So I would like to amend the motion to approve to strike out the term limit portion of this ordinance.
Second. Got a first and second. Any other discussion? Yes.
Madam Mayor, I also have thought about this a lot. I look at my own personal experience being on the Planning Commission since, I believe, December, and how much I've learned since then, and knowing how much more I need to learn to be effective in that position. It is a lot of work. It's a lot of knowledge that a lot of people don't just have off the street. And I actually have some very, very limited background there. It's highly technical. It's a lot of work. I mean, a lot. And I would think it becomes a little bit less burdensome the more you know about it, and it's easier to go through these plans and see what specific items you need to be looking for. And I've heard it said that it takes your first 3 years to really catch up to speed and know what you're doing. And I think that's probably correct. And if we limit this to two terms, then we're really getting one effective term out of a planning commissioner. Also, we've moved forward in the issue of term limits for the Board of Commissioners itself. And I think that creates a term limit of sorts as it would apply to the Planning Commission also, because there's going to be automatic turnover up here, which means as those people come off and come back up for reappointment, you're going to have new people sitting here with different ideas and a different vision of how the city should go forward. And I think that would, at that point, they'll make a decision, this person doesn't meet that vision, and I want to make a change. So it kind of a quasi-term limit to them by giving us one. I want the city to be successful in its planning mission, and I think that is having the highly qualified people there. As a compromise, I would suggest maybe we have a term limit on the offices on the Planning Commission so that we will have a turnover of leadership without necessarily losing that experience. So we get a different chairperson every so often, which can help steer the ship, so to speak. And I think that might be helpful. I just look at what would happen if we have too much turnover too quick on the Planning Commission. That's a scary thought of adding too many new members and not having that experience. Especially with what we have coming up, we've got a lot of subdivisions coming. We've got a lot of development coming. This is the time, maybe more so than 4 or 5 years ago, where we really need that experience on the Planning Commission. And so those are concerns I have about limiting that by a term limit.
Okay. Vice Mayor.
Thank you, Mayor. Couple things. I don't disagree with Commissioner Burks about the officer part of that. I don't know if that would be something. I'm not sure if that's part of statute that creates at least a chairperson, or if that's something that's created by the bylaws of the Planning Commission. It would have to be changed by the Planning Commission. Do you know, Mr. Collins?
It is included in the bylaws of the Planning Commission. You could, given the fact that the Board of Commissioners appoints members of the Planning Commission, you could in fact do that as a part of your appointment authority, so you could do it either way. You could leave it up to them in the bylaws, or you could include it in your ordinance as a part of those appointment powers, whichever way you chose.
Thank you. I personally would prefer to leave that to the Planning Commission. I mean, I think, you know, it's we're appointing those members, with the exception of the two that are on this Board of Commissioners that sit on the Planning Commission. You know, I think they should be able to appoint, I mean, obviously they're appointing the person, but I think they should be able to decide whether or not that person's doing a good job or not, the same as we get to decide whether or not they're doing a good job on the Planning Commission and can remove them. That's voted on every year, as I understand it, based on the bylaws. And I appreciate what Commissioner Burris is saying. I understand that, but I would personally prefer that we just allow them to make those appointments. You know, I mean, we're entrusting them with a lot of very, very important things. They probably decide some of the most important things that go on in the city. And, you know, I think we can entrust them to decide on who they want to be their chairperson and secretary and so forth. But another thing that Commissioner Burks talked about was is we are on the cusp of some significant development, and we've lost two planning commissioner members that have some significant experience recently. And in light of that, I just feel like we could really make a bad decision by doing this. And we're trying to do it in the interest of doing the right thing, because we've seen some stuff and we know that we need to make some changes. But I don't want to make change just for the sake of making change and it severely hurt us down the road because we don't have the experience that we need on that particular commission. So I agree with Commissioner Burks on that point for certain.
Mayor?
Yes.
I agree with, but I mean, I've never really understood why we were discussing term limits, because you're right. Every time they reapply, we have the right then to stop their term. I do agree with Commissioner Burks that possibly it would be easier for us to say you can be chairman for two terms or three terms. That way it's automatic. They know that. So there's not that ability for some, I mean, there wasn't even a slate of officers presented. It was just a motion that we remain, which makes it hard, I think, for someone else in that Planning Commission to step up and say, we want to change the officers. So would that not be easier for the board to say, we would like for y'all to change officers. You can only serve so many terms in that position.
If I may, and again, Commissioner Rainey, I completely understand, and I don't disagree with what any of you guys are saying. It's just that the way I took what happened that night that the officers were elected the very first night is I took that there was no one else necessarily wanting to step up and be an officer. I mean, there was a motion that was put forward to change at least the chairperson position, and it didn't even get a second for whatever reason. I mean, and there's you know, other than the person that made the motion, there were eight other people sitting up here that could have seconded that motion. And it wasn't until there was a resignation that, you know, that of course forced the hand of the Planning Commission to elect at least a new chairperson and elect some new officers. So I understand what we're trying to accomplish, but in reality, it just seemed like that there was no one really willing to step up and take on that role for whatever reason. And I mean, maybe if we put that provision in place, then they don't have a choice. I mean, eventually that chairperson is going to term out, and they're going to have to find somebody that's willing to take on that role. Because what I've seen from observing the Planning Commission is you have some members, kind of like every board, you have some members that are outspoken and talk and have, you know, have things to say. And then you have some that they may have a lot of knowledge, but they're quiet, you know, and they don't want to take on the role of chairperson. So I don't know. It's just something else to think about. I'm not an opponent of what you're proposing. Neither of you are proposing necessarily. I just want us to think it through.
Okay. Commissioner Burks.
Madam Mayor. One thing to consider also is that these are one-year terms of office. So it's not a three-year term of office that we're dealing with. We're dealing with 1 year. If we were going to do a term limit on that, I think it would need to be more than one or two terms. It need to be a little bit more lengthy period. Also, we have Mr. Butler present today. Let me put him on the spot. Who is our new chairperson of the Planning Commission? I'd like to get his thought on this topic. He'll come forward. And one thing I would say, it is hard when someone proposes, let's just keep the whole slate as is, it then is a little more difficult for someone to step up and say, hey, no, I think this person should, or I want to do that. And I don't want us to lose that person who might have that new set of eyes and give us a little bit different direction that can, not necessarily that the person's doing bad, but a change is good at times. Things get stale and you want to freshen it up a little bit. Mr. Butler?
If you put on the spot here, just some quick notes. I think that having the Planning Commission having the ability to vote on it, your peers to vote on you to hold that position, I think, as you said, as a year passes, if the nine people sitting up there don't feel like the chairperson is leading the right direction or doing improper things, then they would take the opportunity to elect a new chairperson. I don't know if it would have to necessarily be a forced out change. And like Mr. Crutcher said, or Vice Mayor Crutcher said, maybe somebody is a little softer spoken and doesn't want to take the chairperson seat, and maybe, you know, you force them into a position they wouldn't want to hold. I don't know.
Yeah, the only question I have for you is, now that you've been chair for all of a, has it been a month, almost a month? Have you found it surprising how much that you have to do?
It has increased dramatically, some at my own discretion or choice. I participated in my first staff review meeting a couple Tuesdays ago. It was the first Tuesday after the chairman. It was almost a full half a day staff review meeting here at the City Hall. It's been interesting to see the more involvement, absolutely.
Well, and one of the things that I find is it's normally not that somebody doesn't want to lead the meeting, but a lot of individuals don't step up. They may be knowledgeable and they might be great as chairing, but in the Planning Commission is one of those positions you're asked to do a lot more. So if you have a 9-to-5 job, you're not going to be able to drop in the middle of the day and come and sit at City Hall for 4 hours. So it's not always about you can't, you know, we're not giving people opportunity to serve, that you're not having to jump, a lot of people jump up to serve because the requirements are much more for a Planning Commission chair. Because you also have to sign the plats, and there are several times in a week that you're contacted to come in as building goes. So just to make it aware, it may not even be how chairs get stuck in a chair role. It's you may have board members that just don't have that kind of day, but they want to serve on your Planning Commission.
Sorry. Yes.
Thank you. Anybody else? Okay, we have a motion. Any more discussion? Did we get the second? Okay.
Could we hear the motion? The motion by Vice Mayor Crutcher was to strike the term limit portion of the ordinance and otherwise approve.
Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
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 Opposed? Motion carries. Okay, G, discuss and take action on ordinance 2017-7.
An ordinance to amend the City of Fairview, Tennessee Municipal Code, Title 1, General Administration, Chapter 5, Code of Ethics by addition of Section 1-512, Protocol for Board and Commission Members after disclosure of personal interest by members in voting and non-voting matters per Sections 1-503 and 1-504. Move to approve.
Second.
Okay, we have a first and second discussion on this matter.
Mayor, if I might just give you a thumbnail sketch of the ordinance.
Yes.
What it basically does, it says that if you have to disclose that you have a conflict of interest, whether it be a direct or indirect, it then provides a protocol as to what you must do. You must then leave the the area of the podium, leave the room and stay gone until that discussion is over and the vote's taken. And that applies to all the elected board of commissioners and to all commissions and or entities that they appoint. So everybody has the same.
Okay, go ahead.
I agree with this in general principle completely. However, I think there might be a need for a tweak or two. Maybe it's the rule of unintended consequences, as we saw tonight with Mr. Bankrum at the last planning commission, had to recuse himself because he had an interest in the proposed rezoning. And when he came here, he was unable to answer some questions because he did leave the room completely, which I think was appropriate, but then missed the discussion and some of the details that he needed to be able to maybe present to us tonight. Didn't know that there was actually a change he didn't know about in the plan as far as the way the houses were turned. He didn't know how it got to that point. So maybe we need to tweak it a little bit by saying, instead of maybe leaving the room completely, then go sit on the very back row and listen and be able to hear at least, so know it's being discussed. Maybe.
Okay, Vice Mayor.
Thank you, Mayor. I'm flat out not willing to go there with this. I mean, I think that, you know, I talked to Chairperson Butler about this just after a meeting the other night, tree commission meeting, and you know, he had done some research, and he's doing a lot of research in his new role, and he had gone to some commission meetings, planning commission meetings, and part of that preparation for his role, and he said that there was these other municipalities do this exactly like we're proposing it, that they leave the room, and you know, as far as not knowing what was said, you know, there's a representative in this room, and I hope that that representative and whoever's proposing the project know enough about what's going on that they communicate at least about what was said or wasn't said at the planning commission meeting. Further, it's recorded. You can leave here and go watch it. You know, it's available to you to see. So, you know, I think if we want to do this and do it right, you need to leave the room. And that goes for anybody on this board or anyone else based off of how this is written across, you know, across the city.
Mayor?
Yes.
Would it be possible, since we're getting all the new audiovisual equipment, I mean, could there be a speaker put somewhere so they could hear if they needed to?
There will be. That's a part of the package.
Problem solved.
Perfect.
Okay, so do we have the motion? I've already lost it. I guess it's that 9 o'clock break time. No.
It was just a motion to approve.
Okay, so we get a second?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so we're all good. Any other discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Motion carries. Okay, that will bring us to H, discuss and take action and propose contract to Adams Contracting LLC for construction of contract number 120027, Safe Routes to School. City staff want to say anything? Mr. Hall? I guess this is probably self-explanatory, but.
Yes, ma'am. We just need the signature to move forward with. We've been asked to go to construction finally, so that's where we're at. So this will approve the contract with the low bidder.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Did I miss something? Yes.
I was just checking my packet to make sure it wasn't emailed. I haven't seen the contract. It wasn't included in the packet.
We have a copy. It is this thick. Mr. Cantrell has gone over it. There are no issues with the contract that legal has been able to provide for us, and it's a standardized contract for the performance. It's also a grant project that would include federal funding, and that's a part of that contract as well. We'll be glad to get a copy and provide it. Okay. We have it here. We just is a pretty thick document, exceptionally thick document, actually.
I have a spare copy if you want it.
But Mr. Cantrell's looked at it.
It's very thick. Yes, I have looked at it. It's very similar to most any kind of contract that for this type of work that's produced by the people that are going to do the work. I had no problem with it, assuming a couple of things, that at the closing, all the signatures that are necessary are properly affixed, which obviously they were not at this time. In a deference to my good friend Mr. Will back there, there's a lot of stuff in there about slumps on concrete and asphalt content and recyclable asphalt, which I offer no opinion of. I don't know if they're good, bad, or indifferent. It's outside of my scope, but the contract I don't really have any problem with.
Move to approve.
Second.
Got a first and second. Any more discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Motion carries. Item I, discuss and take action on notice to proceed for the Adams Contract Ding LLC on Safe Routes to School.
Move to approve.
Second.
Got a first and second. Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Motion carries. Item 11, City Manager's Items of Discussion.
Mayor, members of council, I have, our commission, I have only about 90 minutes worth of information to go over with you. Just a couple. First off, Commissioner Rainey mentioned the council chambers. We met for the administrative committee this week to go over that. We're substantially ready to move forward with that project. We do have our two bids. They did come in under. We solicited three. We got two. They did come in under what our anticipated costs were. We're looking at adding a couple of changes to there, but we hope to be able to proceed with that at the end of this month or the 1st of May and have this room, the improvements completed by the fiscal year, which will be June 30. We'd like to have that project move forward. We don't anticipate any issues with that. The two vendors we have are ready to go. They were within $1,500 of each other for the total project, so we're comfortable there. We just want to make sure we're not missing anything as we get forward. That's a pretty important improvement to this room, and we're comfortable with where we are in that process. As you know, we've gone through a department head interview process, just as a reminder. In addition to the police chief, which we've done, we have also hired a city planner. Her anticipated start date was April 17. It will now be 1 week later, April 24. We look forward to having her on board. The fire department has worked with me on the fire chief search. We've conducted five interviews for fire chief. We anticipate two more. I can tell you that the three captains in the fire department have put a substantial amount of work in and have represented the city exceptionally well in those interviews, and we hope to have that decision made no later by the end of next week for that position to be filled. Three more things. I'll be brief. Just a quick thank you to the staff. There's a lot that goes on behind the scenes, and I had a conversation with a couple of board members this week. And I can tell you that behind the scenes, the things that you don't see for the city that go on just for the operation of the city, the staff has really stepped up. There is a lot of work going on, and I just want to just publicly thank them for their efforts in that. It is a busy time of year. There's a lot of work being done by the city, and they have just really done a great job helping us partner move forward, so I can't thank them enough. Next to last on the fireworks, amenable to the board, I'm going to provide you a couple of ordinance samples. There are some ways to restrict that. I'm not specific to business type. You can do it to number of linear feet in between the number of businesses. You can require so many feet from a fire hydrant. You can require so many feet from a fixed restroom facility, a temporary vendor form, any number of ways to get that to accomplish what you want to accomplish. We just want to make sure we have an ordinance that gets and accomplishes your goal. But those are relatively standard. We'll get copies of those, and you can just adopt one part or some version of that. And lastly, just a sincere thank you to Mr. Cantrell. Mr. Cantrell has been a part of the city, as I understand it, for about 13 years. There's a lot that's gone on in this city that's been good over those 13 years. This is his last meeting here as city attorney. I, on behalf of the city, want to just offer him a thank you for his service to the city over that time, and a personal thank you over the last 7 months that I've been involved with the city and my opportunity to work with him. My first day here, August 1st, I had an opportunity to meet with Mr. Cantrell in his office. I didn't know anyone or anything. I didn't know how to get to Nashville. We sat down in his office. He spent some time, and the opportunity that he took with me just to work for the process for how the city works and some background was invaluable to me. So just as a part of where we go, this is a chapter for us. The city's growing, but it's certainly not closing a chapter on a friendship and a service to the city that does need to be forgotten. So just a quick thank you to Mr. Cantrell for all he's done for the city and helping us prep to move forward. And that's all I have for you tonight.
Okay, thank you. Commissioner Rainey.
Well, Mr. Cantrell, thank you for your service. And I also want to publicly thank, for the first time ever during alternative spring break, we had the need to have the police called. And I just want to publicly thank the chief of police and the assistant chief for the way they handled it. It was professional. I was absolutely blown away and grateful. So thank you.
Commissioner Lucas.
I'd like to say thank you to Mr. Cantrell, too. Haven't been working with you very long, but when I have worked with you, it's been great. So thank you for your service. I appreciate it.
Okay, Commissioner Burks.
I'll echo that, Mr. Cantrell. Thank you very much. You've put in a lot of time and effort in our city, and that is very appreciated. I'm glad we were able to move forward with some issues tonight. I think the city is going in a very good direction. That's what I'm hearing from people, that they appreciate the steps we've taken. I don't do it for those reasons to hear the thanks. I do it because I think it's the right thing to do. And I think we all do that. And I really appreciate the fact that we can come together and work as a cohesive group to move the city forward. So I'd like to thank my fellow commissioners as well. Thank you.
Vice Mayor.
Thank you, Mayor. I think we accidentally skipped Mr. Cantrell, so I don't know if you had anything that you wanted to say before I remark.
I'm so sorry.
That's quite all right. No, it's probably like Abraham Lincoln said, excuse me, the world will live an older long. Remember what I say here. And considering the late hour, I'll make it very brief. I just want to thank all the past and present members of boards, commissions, special committees that were appointed, employees and staff, and 5 city managers that I was privileged to work with. Thank you. That's all I have.
Thank you, Mr. Cantrell. I want to thank Mr. Cantrell as well. I've been on this board for the past 2.5 years and have worked with him, and I know that's just a very brief part of his tenure here. He's always handled himself very professionally and done diligent work and came prepared for whatever issue that we presented, and I appreciate that. And thank you for your service.
Sorry about that. Didn't mean to skip over you. I think I was just more going shocked that you were, this was it, or I would have said something earlier to you. But it just, thank you. I mean, we've actually worked together, 6 years on the board, but then the years in the Planning Commission. So I've got to see you work a lot and dedicated, misses no meetings except when he had to in the hospital, and rare occasions came in here probably when he shouldn't have been coming here, but just due to the commitment to the city, he made sure he made it to the meeting. So that never went unnoticed, and I appreciate your service and the time. And boy, we've been through some interesting times, but I'm glad that you were here, and I just wish you the best. And then just to close tonight, I know some of the conversations seem painful long, and we did made what I thought was going to be a short agenda pretty quick, but I just think it's part of it. I think right now, as we're making those key decisions for the city and the future, is we have to have discussions about a PUD. And I enjoyed having Will here and Brandon here and being able to contribute. Sorry to keep y'all from your families one more night, but it really did serve a great purpose. And as we figure out and have that directions for, we're not making mistakes. And so I really appreciate y'all's time. So that's it. If I can get a motion to adjourn.
Motion.
Okay, so move.